It's good to have everybody here this morning. Now we are, we're doing something new. Yes. Some of you are like, no, we just got used to it. No, but here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna try something new here for a while. How many of you would agree with me? And if you don't agree with me, you're more than welcome to be wrong, that's fine. But how many of you would say that we move, our world moves at a very, very fast pace? Would you agree with that? That it just feels Sunday to Saturday, we are just constantly moving. That even at church, when you show up at church, sometimes it just feels like bam, 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 bam. Park, get in, get the kids, get your little number, go, sit, worship, sing, listen. He talks way too fast, fill in the blanks, wonder if God has something for me, leave, clear my parking spot out so somebody else can park there, rinse and repeat, rinse it, right? We go through this over and over again. And it's something that's kind of burdening me. And one of the things that we're gonna try and do is how do we slow down a little bit? Like how does church become an opportunity for us to just breathe a little bit, to experience a rest and a pace that might be a little bit more healthy? And one way that we're gonna be doing that, just for the rest of this year, a little experiment we're gonna do is the final week of every series that we do, we're gonna pause and we're gonna reflect and have communion together. And we'll talk about communion in a minute. Some of you, like, every muscle just tensed up. Like, it's the first time you're in church and I just said, like, communion, and you're like, oh, I didn't take the course, you know, don't worry about it. There's no class you have to take, all right? And what we're gonna do is we're gonna reflect on what God has been speaking to us over the last series. So no new content. We're driven by content in our world. Like every day, new content. And so you come to church and it's the same thing, it's new content. But what we wanna do is just reflect. Like, what has God been speaking to us? So I'm gonna invite at the end of every series, 2-3 people to come and join and just share how God has been working in their life through the series. How has it been challenging them? And these are everyday normal people, not like me. Okay? I'm a professional Christian. And it's not a great profession to be in, by the way, all right? But that's the truth, and so I get it. Like, some of you are like, oh, well, you're paid to experience God. Like, you're paid to read the Bible. I understand that. So that invalidates some of my, you know, my experiences. But just normal, everyday folks like yourself that are Curtis Lake Church that God is moving in. And so we're going to invite them to share. How has God been speaking? Because that's the goal. Like, oh, the goal is not that we made it through. We finished the series. We studied that book of the Bible. The goal is that we're being transformed every day, that we're being no longer conformed to the patterns of this world, but being transformed by the renewing of our minds. But if our minds are always just being filled with information and we never have a moment to reflect and pause and be transformed, then we're just kind of going through the motions. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to hear from a couple of folks as they just are wrestling with some of the things we've been talking about. All right, so do me a favor and welcome to the stage Peter Holt and Esther Lee Samia, and they're going to come and share with us today. Welcome them up. All right. Join me on the kickout little platform here. And as we get started, so your goal today is two things. One is to listen to how God has been working in their lives, but you have a sheet of paper inside of your program, and you need to be asking yourself this question: how has God been speaking to me through this series? How is God working in my life? Now, you might say, well, Ryan, this is my first week here. I don't know how God's speaking to me through this series. I haven't been here. Fair enough. So your question is, what has God been doing to get my attention? Maybe your question is, what in the world am I doing here today? Why am I here today? And I would challenge you to put a little spin on it. Maybe you're trying to figure out why you're here. It's like, bring the assumption of God. Why does God, maybe you have no concept of who God is or what God is, but let's just talk in real big theoretical terms. Why does God have me here today? And you'd be surprised when we start asking questions how often God answers, all right? So that's what we want to do. We want to explore. So before we kind of jump in, tell us a little bit about yourselves, your story, what you fill your days with throughout the week, and a little bit of your journey to this point. Esther, why don't you go first?
Hi, Esther Lee Samia. Brian is my husband. Hi. I'm going to edit my message because he's here this time. But anyways.
Yeah, we'll leave that stuff out.
So I grew up in this community, and went away for college, didn't think I was ever going to come back, and then that tall drink of water got me back here. And so my plans changed.
We're talking about Brian?
We're talking
about Brian. Okay, I just want to be sure. Right.
Last time
Unless she, Tom Brady's
she pointed
there?
At somebody no. else last time said the same joke, and I was very confused, but okay.
So I came back, so that's one of the many things in my life that didn't go according to plan. I currently, and even the job I do now, I'm an American Sign Language interpreter, fell into that career, just sort of stumbled into it, I'm a mother of two. Didn't stumble into that one, but gave it much thought. But if you talk to my 18-year-old self and she saw all those things, she'd be like, oh no, you are not doing that to me. Like, So alas, here I am.
Excellent. Well, thank you for being here today, Esther. Peter.
Peter Holt, husband. Jennifer, my wife, is here somewhere. It's hard to see with these lights on. But I see everybody pointing at her, so that's good. At least everybody else knows where she's at. We have three small kids, 2, 4, and 6 here as well. Jennifer and I started coming here a little over seven years ago. And I was brought up in the church growing up. My family, we moved around a lot, kind of through Connecticut area, but we were brought up in the church a lot. It was pretty interesting because I learned a lot about God growing up, and I learned a lot about, you know, what it meant to walk by faith and walk with God and all that stuff. But it wasn't really until God opened my eyes really through a lot of stuff that we're learning here as far as who God really is and how much he really loves you that I've really learned as an adult. We live here in Berwick. I think I said that. Maybe I didn't. I live here in Berwick. I am self-employed, and my wife, who is a stay-at-home mom, is far busier than I am.
Excellent. Well, thank you. So if you see really, really clean floors, it's Peter's fault right there. So we've been in this series, Walkabout. Right? Stumbling or wandering into a meaning-filled heart. And the first week we kind of introduced this and what we've been studying, for those of you that maybe are new and weren't here, is we've been studying this book of the Bible called Ecclesiastes, which can be, at surface level, a really depressing book. Like, you read this and you're like, oh my goodness, like, why do we even bother with existence? But we've been exploring how what Solomon was wandering through, and he was going on this journey to find, where do you find meaning in life? And what we said in that first week was, what he discovered was, you don't find meaning in things, you bring meaning to things. That's the beauty of following Jesus. That's the beauty of understanding God's plan for our world, is that we have this great opportunity to not need to find meaning, but we bring meaning. And so then we, over the next kind of 7-8 weeks, started looking at different passages, walking through this book, and we looked at, what does it mean to bring meaning and to search for meaning in pleasure, in materialism, in wisdom, work, wealth? What does it mean to search for meaning without Jesus? And then last week, Josh talked about searching for meaning in power and position. So as we've kind of gone through these topics, the first question is, have there been areas of your life where you look back and say, or maybe, you know, maybe you don't have to look back too far, maybe it was like earlier this morning or whatever, but there's a tendency to say, I'm going to find my meaning in there. And maybe you've gone through that and you've kind of walked past it, but has there been an area, and what has God been kind of doing in your life through this series? So we'll start with you, Peter. How does that hit you?
Yeah, growing up, I noticed, as I look back at my childhood and my young adult life, I noticed I really, even though I was a Christian, even though I knew God and went to church and did all that stuff, I really found that I searched for meaning more in my friends and in my acquaintances, my relationships, than I did in my walk with God. To be honest, I really didn't feel that kind of, I don't know, acceptance maybe at home that I felt in my friends. You know, your friends encourage you, that, you know, whatever they're in. I wanted to do the things my friends did because that's where I felt valued. That's where I felt encouraged. That's where I felt appreciated more so. So I found my meaning more so in that, or searched for meaning in that. I didn't find my meaning in that. I should correct that probably. But I really searched for meaning as well in stuff. Without God. Again, I knew who I was in God, but I still wanted to feel a different type of value, I guess, in front of other people. Mm.
So as we explored, like, some of those things, like, what resonated with you? What was God kind of teaching you about that?
Through all of it, he always brought back the fact that those were empty. Anything I've ever tried to search for or tried to obtain or tried to grab for myself, he's always shown me that is empty. I mentioned before, I wish I was more like Solomon in the fact that when Solomon searched for meaning in all these other things, as we looked over this in the past few weeks, Solomon looked purposefully for meaning in specific areas, specific things. And when he realized there was no meaning in it, he walked away from that and he went on to something different. Where me, I'm just so blindsided by the fact that I'll look for meaning in things or look for meaning in people or look for meaning in relationships or whatnot, and I'll still go back to those same circumstances instead of, even though I'll realize in my heart, now my real meaning is found in God, I still find myself wandering back into those other areas.
Interesting. Thank you. Esther, how about you? As we've gone through this series, what's God been speaking to you about meaning and areas of your life?
Yeah, well, all of the weekly messages applied to me. I've gone through a season, I've walked through it, you know, where I tried to find my identity in, you know, where I was at, you know, physically, like, Sanford, small town, I'm going to the big city, I'm going to arrive. Education, you know, my husband is just like, not another degree, honey, but I'm like, really? I can. And, you know, education's great, all those things are great. Job, you know, obviously, you want to do well at your job, but it does not define who you are. Your money, you know, you want more of it, but it doesn't define who you are. You know, I struggled through those things in different phases of my life, especially, you know, your quarter life crisis you get out of college, you know, like, I'm going to make it big, look at me, and then it doesn't happen, and then you're just like, am I a failure? And, you know, I was a Christian at that time, but, you know, I had also gone through phases where, you know, I love you, God, what's next, to do I really need you, God? Like, yeah, I can do this on my own. You know, I've obviously found meaning in Jesus at this point, but I mean, that was a walk too. And thankfully that's not chasing the wind, because I've found more joy and meaning in him in whatever position, job, or thing I have now. But I definitely went through that. But, you know, coming through the series, you know, it was great to reflect on how far I've come, but I was kind of like cocky. I'm like, thank God I'm not there anymore. I'm over that struggle. And then it hit, you know, finding meaning without Jesus, you know, the little nesting dolls. And I was like, oh, you know, I feel areas of blame in this area, and anger here, and fear here, and those aren't, you know, fruits of the Spirit. So I was like, oh, okay, I have my own little nesting dolls, like in, you know, Esther at work, Esther at home, Esther walking with God, and, you know, Esther in the car when she's late. So, you know, that was a very powerful paradigm for me to realize, like, I'm not stagnant and I'm not one person. I've got areas that I need to work with, you know, and like, why do I feel isolated? Why am I angry? Why am I fearful? And like, okay, inside there's the Holy Spirit. Like, I got to unleash that little doll.
Yeah. So like, you might have come to grips with God has you here. And yes. So you kind of have wrestled with the meaning in zip code.
Yes.
But there's other spaces where the kind of meaning creeped in and some of those layers came out, and so there was still fear there, or whatever it might be.
Absolutely.
And so that different layers, that's very fascinating. So as you have, as you're walking with the Lord, right, as you're trying to just figure this thing out, like, I'm a human being, I'm a father, a mother, I work, I have responsibilities. We kind of came to this conclusion in Ecclesiastes through Solomon, as he looks at all these things in life, our anchor verse was Ecclesiastes 12:13. He says, that's the whole story. So he's like, walked through everything. He's like, it's all meaningless. It's all chasing the wind. He says, that's the whole story. Here now is my final conclusion. Fear God and obey his commands, for this is everyone's duty. And he brings it down to, this is the point of life. This is where you're going to bring meaning to. This is what's going to allow you to bring meaning, is fear God, obey his commands. And Jesus steps on the scene, right, hundreds of years later, and he says, the two greatest commandments are love God and love others. And you know we love him by obedience, right? And so he just kind of takes up this same mantle and says, that's it. So as you're loving God, as you're loving others, as you're trying to live this life that says, hey, pleasure and possessions and work, these aren't bad things, but they become bad things when they start to be identity. Like, what is the priority right now in your life that God is molding? Like, what's the priority for you in your relationship with Jesus? How is he saying to you, we're working on this. Like, this is my priority in your life. Because he doesn't take all of us at once. He doesn't take every area and start, like, messing with us. Because then we'd be like, oh, overwhelmed. But he'll just take kind of one area at a time and mold us into his image. And then he takes another area. So what's that area right now in your life? Esther, you get to go first.
Okay, first. Okay. I'm a work in progress. It was news to me that I am not perfect. why does it take me this long? So, you know, my journey with God has been decades long, and it's just been very slow, and thank God for his grace, because I have not been a very productive follower of God. So he works with me. I feel close to him in prayer, which is great, but I feel like he's working with me as far as time, talent, and treasure. It's definitely time. I value my time. I use excuses like, I'm a terrible time management person. I'm like, I can't connect with you. I'm sorry. I'm really bad with my time. Or I can't do this. I can't take on another responsibility or ministry just to meet with someone because I'm really bad with my time, which is just a lame excuse. It's true. I am awful. Awful, 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 awful. But you can leave that at the feet of the Lord, and he's going to find that time for you, you know, to make it a priority. So really, it was an excuse for priority. And yes, time is, you know, fleeting, and it's a resource, but it's a resource that's not mine, and I've got to give that to him. And, you know, he does not need you to be a specialist. So I'm like, I just have to reach out to other people, because otherwise I'm going to keep isolating. And community is messy. And I just got to get over that. Like, it's not going to be perfect. It's not going to be Pinterest worthy. And whatever.
What? How dare you shatter my dreams.
So I always start my home teams. And this is a leap of faith. Just keep doing the home teams. It's worth it. It's an act of faith. But, you know, like, it kept me. I kept myself from doing it because my house wasn't clean enough. Or they're not going to like me. Or I'm not going to say the right things. And then, you know, I've had a few home teams. And like, oh, honey, if you got coffee, we're here. Like, thank God, because my house is a mess. I can see the dust bunnies running, and I'm like, please don't judge me. And yeah, just do it. Just do it. They just want coffee.
Excellent. There you go. So maybe that's what God wanted you to hear. They just want coffee. That's it.
Forgot the dust bunnies.
That's great. So it almost sounds like something that God's working in your heart is you don't have to have control of everything for your time to be redeemed by him.
Shocking. Right? So what do you mean? I got this under control, God. There's a pin on it somewhere in Pinterest.
Right.
I got this.
That's right. Peter, how about you? What do you sense is God's priority for your life right now that he's shaping you in?
Sure. Definitely in my walk with him. It's really comfortable talking to God, praying to God, walking with God. I find myself as an adult focusing very easily on noticing the different things God's doing in my life, areas that he's working, day-to-day things, simple little routine things, I see God's hand at work in it. So that stuff's easy. My biggest struggle is devotional time. I hate to read. Ask my wife. She is a readaholic. That girl can read, read, read. I hate to read. I can sit down at night, and if I have a screen in front of me, and I'm scrolling through something on a screen, how many of you are like this? You scroll. I can scroll for hours, especially like if it's Craigslist, right, hon? I can scroll for hours looking at stuff and just reading little bits of information, new cleaning technology stuff. I'm all into that stuff. I'll sit down, and I'll open up my Bible, or any book, but in my Bible, I'll sit down and read. Within 5 minutes, I am out like a light. I struggle. No, and it's not,
it's
an
it's God's peace that is overwhelming you.
No, it's, and I have to pray on a regular basis that God just puts in my heart that desire to have more desire for his word than for Craigslist. More desire for his word than to sit downstairs and watch him. And that's my struggle. That's where I have a difficult time. And I find that I know is what God has been speaking to me about, is you need to spend more time with me like this. Yeah, in music, I surround myself predominantly with Christian music, with upbeat, you know, positive music. My prayer walk with him and all that stuff's good. But it is that specific time with him in his word that is where I fall short all the time. One of the ways that God has really been at work over the years and helping me with that, is especially because I don't like to read, is home teams. Many times we've been asked to lead or participate in a different home team. And for those of you who are involved in home teams, you know, a lot of times there's some study or, you know, reading or something that you got to do to keep up with the week. And I find myself forcing myself to do that. And I like that because I'm actually doing something that I really want to do. I just am lazy and don't do on my own. So I need that motivation.
The accountability that's formed there. Absolutely. I feel like we've got a little mini infomercial for home teams, but there's nothing on the car that was just when
and
I
And sign-ups are.
So, like, if you've been fighting joining a home team, I think God is definitely telling you something today because that was not on the agenda. But so question that was not given to you ahead of time. This is the change, and I'll give you a chance to think about what is the most shameful thing you've ever done. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh,
I'm just messing with you.
Esther's going first.
Just icebreaker. So now this question won't feel bad at all. Like, this question will be really easy. Don't worry about it. So one of the things that is in my heart for us as a community of faith is that we get a hold and of this deep belief that God is speaking to us individually every day of our lives. And we use scripture to affirm what he says to us so we don't go off the rails, you know, but God is speaking to us, and he speaks to us uniquely, and it's not necessarily and probably not going to be an audible voice, but it's going to be through an experience, and that each one of us are wired unique to start to discern how God speaks to us. And I think in my life, I've seen patterns that if I put myself in this situation in life, God will speak to me. So God, I find, for example, one way that God speaks to me is through reading. Not necessarily scripture, but just reading in general. So if I read, I sense God, and there'll be a statement or a passage or a sentence that I go, there's something there that God is either speaking into my life, or I'm always kind of thinking around sermon topics and series. And it might even be a lot of times God will speak to me through television or, you know, radio, that these are things in culture that we're wrestling with. So we put ourselves in positions, but I always sense that nudge, you know, and so I've kind of learned over years, like, I think that's God. Like, that, I had never had that thought before. I wouldn't have thought of that way on my own. So I go, I feel like that might be the mind of Christ. How in your life have you learned, or are you learning to discern, here's how God speaks to me personally, and maybe something that he's been saying, but just How does he speak to you? Peter, we'll start with you.
I'm still stuck on the first question. I'm trying to get that out of my head.
You're like, how do I pick?
That was this morning. I find that God, again, like what you said, it is. I'll sense that nudging. If somebody's asking me to do something or speaking something into my life, there's so many different ways of looking at this. If it's God asking me to do something, I'll really notice that he's asking me, typically, like my heart, I'll have a desire for something or a passion for something. Okay, I'll question that and be like, all right, God, is this from you? Is this what you want me to do? I'll follow through it if it is, if it's not, close the door kind of thing. Other times it's like, well, it's like this. Doug sent out an email asking for us to be on this panel to do this, and I knew how I was going to handle this, and I handled it exactly how I knew I was going to handle it. Ignore the email. You laugh, I'm serious. I ignored the email because I knew I wasn't going to respond. I know there's a lot of you out here, everyday people, not professional Christians, who Doug could use to come up here and just, you know, be in this awkward situation.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thanks. But I honestly, I said to myself, no, I'm just going to ignore that. Doug will find somebody else. I happen to be here, I think it was that same day, in just puttering around in one of the rooms over here. And as I was, Doug, and I've never run into him, walks in the room on me, just happens to see me. Oh, this is fortuitous, he says. And I looked up at him thinking, no, please, this is not about your email. Did you get my email? Yep, I did. And I just smirked at him. And he laughed at me because he realized that, I think, that he's ignoring it. I knew then, I can't ignore this. And God does stuff like that in my life, not just with that big events like that, but he'll bring stuff back into my life that he's like, no, I'm serious about this. This is something I want you to do. It has nothing to do with you. It's everything about me, but I want you to do this. So in those situations, I'll step back and I'll just be like, all right, God, if this is what you want me to do, you provide, you do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to be obedient. I'm going to give what I have to you. You do what you need to do.
That's great. Esther, how about you?
Yeah. My narrative just changed. But for me, it was just, it's doing the work. It was just being obedient because I've been a part of this church for decades. And I just faithfully kept coming back. My mom would encourage me to come, but I wasn't really getting spoken to, or it just wasn't my time. But I just kept coming back, whether it was, you know, just to be a good girl in the name or the roll call when God should come. I'm like, I came to church, God, I'm saved. So that was my immaturity, but I just kept working at it. It wasn't glorious, and I just was like, bored, but you know.
I was super captivating those years, I'm sure.
Yes, you were. And then he put, you know, circumstances in my life. He, you know, if I had read Ecclesiastes, it probably would have saved me a whole lot of heartache. But, you know, I needed to chase my tail. So, you know, I finally arrived at a point where I'm like, this is all meaningless. But my mom just, like, keep going to church and keep tithing. And I'm
like, I don't even make any money. She's like, even better, you get to tithe less. I was like, okay, all right, you know, that excuse is out the door. Here's my 20 bucks. So I just kept coming and coming, and then the messages just started to speak to me. And like, I know that this, sometimes you just feel barrage, like, oh, another thing to do. You know, I actually have to reflect on the message. Like, I can't just zip out of the parking lot. Do it. You know, I mean, maybe don't do it every time, but sometimes when they tell you, you know, reflect or read, you know, actually do it and you will grow. And I said this, but I'm going to refine it. I had said, you know, what you put in is what you get out of it, but God's economy is just so much greater. What you put into it, whether it's just asking God, like, why am I here? Do I really have to come? What are you doing in my life? Do I really need to? Just keep asking that, and God will answer, but he answers infinitely more generous. Like, if I compared where I am, like, the plan, if I just looked at the bio stats, I'm like, that's not where I want to end up. I don't want to be a mother. I don't want to be in Sanford. I don't want to be married to Brian Samia, the cool kid who dumped me in high school. Coming back to him.
Oh, wait, let's sit on this one for a second.
A doll just opened up.
Whoa.
I'm not going back to him.
I feel
I'm
a
so
mic drop
than
coming.
That.
I don't know.
True. All true. So, like, if I compared that, you know, to where I was 18, you know, like, it just doesn't compute, you know? But I have so much more joy with, you know, whatever the job, the place where I'm at, just because I have Jesus, you know, in most areas. And if I'm not acting godly, be like, where's your nesting dolls, honey?
That's
just
great.
Keep doing the work, you know, awesome. Keep asking wherever that is.
Yeah. So it sounds like God speaks to you, and when you ask,
yes.
For you, there's a very intentional,
yes.
Like, I need to ask the question, and then God will overwhelm me with what he's saying. That's fantastic. Would you thank them for coming and being with us today? Just close your eyes with me. What is it that God wants you to know about him or about yourself? Sometimes we rush and we ask the question, God, what do you want me to do? But I think the more pressing question is, what does God want me to know about him and know about myself that will change everything I do? So what has God been showing you and teaching you today, this series, this week? Father, Ecclesiastes teaches us that it is hard to see when our eyes are on me. That when we look through the lens of ourselves, at our possessions and our passions, at our work, when we see these things as opportunities for us to find meaning, they fail us and leave us chasing the wind. But when we see everything through your lens, through the redemption of you, Jesus, on the cross, and we bring that into every situation of our lives. We redeem everything in our lives through you, and we bring meaning and purpose, your grace and your hope and your truth. So would you make our lives a prayer to you, God? And will you meet us where we are and give us the assurance that we will spend eternity with you because we have surrendered our lives to you and we've received the forgiveness that is available to us through your blood and through your broken body? That we don't have to understand everything, but we come in faith. Lord, every sin on this planet that has ever been committed, that will ever be committed, has been forgiven in the cross and in the resurrection. But we need to be reconciled to you, God. And so help us to come and receive that forgiveness and walk in that forgiveness and be reconciled and develop intimacy with our Father in heaven. And so we thank you for sending your son to die on a cross for us, that all who believe would not perish but have everlasting life. For Jesus did not come into this world to condemn the world, but to save it. And so we stand here and sit here grateful for that.